Live. Welcome to Seize Your Mind, the podcast about soccer, mental toughness, and life. Today's guest is Coach Charlie Mitchell. Charlie played in Scotland, where he's originally from, for St. Mirren FC. And then in the NASL, he played with Rochester Lancers, New York Cosmos with Pele, Team Hawaii. In 78, he played for the Tulsa Roughnecks, then the Toronto Blizzard, and then as a coach for Team Hawaii, the Tulsa Roughnecks in 80 and 81. 81's the year that I was born. And for Northeastern State University for 9 years, where I actually played for Charlie in 2004, I believe. Yes, 2004 for a semester. Short stint there. How are you, Charlie?
We're doing great, thank you. And thanks very much for the opportunity to talk to with you. Looking forward to it. And by the way, I like your shirt.
Thank you.
Shirt you've got on there.
I wore it specially for you.
Okay, well, we appreciate it.
All right, Charlie, take me back to the beginning. How did you get involved in soccer as a kid?
Well, I mean, with being born in Scotland, you know, I'd say, when you become 4 or 5 years of age, you just start kicking a tennis ball around the house. And then when you get limit 6 or 7, you get a couple of your pals and you go out on the street and you put 2 jackets down, and the jackets are the goals, and then you just go and just play against each other. And we used to play with a tennis ball, and even head a tennis ball, throw it up, and head it off the wall. So basically, my younger days, 5 through 8, I played all my soccer on the street.
Okay, who was your idol growing up? Did you have a role model?
Yeah, there was 2 big role models in Scotland. There was a guy called Dennis Law, who played for Manchester United, who was a Scottish international player. And he was just a robust, fiery guy who could, you know, just, I loved his style of play. So he was my first hero. And there's another player called Jim Baxter. Jim Baxter played for Glasgow Rangers. And he was a finesse player, and I was left-footed, and he was left-footed, and he was the first guy to wear his shirt outside his pants just to be cool. So I roughly kind of, for the years, I used to wear my shirt outside the pants, and it was kind of untidy, but they just made you look cool as far as I was concerned.
That's great. So when was your first, like, official game in a field?
My first game, in Scotland, obviously, you try to make it the schoolboy. So it's called primary school, which is basically the youngster's school. So 8 years of age, I played for the school team. 8 through 12 got us through the primary school. So all my soccer at the young days, at that age, was all through the school. We'd play every other school in the town. I came from a town of Paisley, and there was about 12 schools there. So yeah, each age group played against each age group on a Saturday morning. Every Saturday morning, you went and played soccer. And the kind of interesting is that when we played there was 20 fields on this one. So all the kids, all the same age group, would go up there, and you'd see all your pals playing in different fields. It was called 20 pitches, which means there were 20 pitches all over in our recreation in our town.
And then, did you go to college after that and play in college, or did you go straight to professional?
No, then I had to go to high school, like basically high school. And you go through high school from 12 through 16. And that's where the soccer get real serious then, because you're getting bigger and stronger. Tackles were getting better. So I went all the way through to played in school. And I was very lucky that I was in a very good team. And we won a couple of trophies all the way through till I was 16 years of age. And then when I was 16, the school team, we didn't have I played for the church as well, but that was just more rec stuff. The school programs were really competitive. And when we were 16, a lot of scouts would come and see us from different, you know, different teams. And we were very successful. My high school team, we'll call it our senior year, we won all the trophies. So we had a lot of scouts come and take a look at us. And myself and 7 other players were very fortunate that after that year, when we were 17, we signed professional contracts.
At 17 years old.
we weren't allowed to get paid for the first 2 years. So we're what's called amateur forms. I was on an amateur form. So your listeners might be interested in that. It's a little bit of a deal where you think you've made the big time. Not really, because when you're what we call an apprentice, an amateur apprentice, we had to clean out the dressing room. We had to polish the boots of the senior players. It was just one of these deals. It was more of a learning program. And one time we had to paint the seats in the stands. We had to go up there and paint the seats. So the glamour for me wasn't what I thought it was going to be. If you want to be a senior player, and you worked hard to be a senior player, so I think that was going to go of the coaches and the trainers, is to get you, not let you get too carried away and let your head get too big. So I never played in the senior team until I was 18 and a half and 19.
Were you always a defender?
No, I used to play left midfield for a while, and then I played center half. Then they became a center back, started to be like 6 feet, 6 foot one, 6 foot two. I was 5'10", so I wasn't tall enough to win all the balls in the middle with the head, basically. And then with being a national left footer, the coach found a left back position. And that just suited me fine because I like to go forward at the same time as I could defend. So the left fullback, the number three position, was just suited me fine. So it worked out good for me.
And then once you played your 18 and a half, tell me about that first game where you're like actually in the big, playing with the big dogs.
I can still remember walking up the tunnel. I was playing with St. Mirren, which is a local team, and they would get something like 20, 25,000 people if they get every game. So walking up that tunnel was a big, big, big thrill. You know, my heart was pounding, and I kept saying, just be cool, just be cool. But there's nothing prepares you for something like that. It's always just you think you want to be cool, you want to calm down, but it's not possible. Your heart's pumping and you just want to play good. You don't want to disappoint. One of the things that was really tough for me and maybe a couple other players, you play for your hometown, then a lot of people come and see you that played with you as a kid or knew you pretty good. So it was kind of tough. It was probably a bad decision to sign for the hometown because you were kind of, I used to play with him. I was a better player than him. I played against him and I kicked him one time. So being a local boy, it was kind of hard, but it was a good lesson to be learned. You were in the public eye.
That's fun. So when did you start with St. Mirren FC?
St. Mirren FC. That was my first professional team to play with, and that was our local professional team. They played in the Scottish First Division, so we got an opportunity to play against Celtic and Rangers and Kilmarnock and Partick Thistle. So it was just great to travel on the bus and be part of an organization like that. What people don't realize that the competition was so stiff that even if you were hurt, you played hurt. If you lost your position in your team, somebody was just breathing right down your neck to take it over. And then if they played good, then you'd be sitting. And we didn't have a bench. I hate to think about it. There was no bench at that time. There was 11 players and one substitute. So it's not like you could sit on the bench. If you didn't play, then you had to go play with the reserve team. And that was like a little kick in the pants that you had to step down. Nobody wanted to go play with the reserve team. Even the word I don't like, reserve team. It was a great process. And I played with a lot of good players, so I was lucky that they helped me get through it.
How did you come over to the U.S.? What was that process like, and what made you?
That was an interesting story. I was one of the younger players on the team at 19 years of age, and they had a couple of scouts came over from America and wanted to take some younger players to play in the off-season. And the off-season in Scotland is basically the summer over here was the off-season over there. So me and three other players got an opportunity to come over and play in the United States. And it was and when I came to Rochester, it was a great experience. Well, the player that I was coming with, he chickened out and decided not to come. Well, when you come to Rochester, they gave us a car to share. Well, with him not coming, I had a little Mustang, and he was me driving a Mustang in Rochester, New York, and the soccer, in all fairness, was easier. The standard wasn't as good, so it made players like myself look better. So it was kind of easy. We used to call it easy to peasy, you know, to come to America. So it was a great, and I played for Rochester for that season, and then went back home to Scotland. And I'll tell you the story. I went back home to Scotland, and I was telling all the players, oh, it was great in America. They give you a car, you know, they give you an apartment. And I was kind of bragging on it all the time. And in Scotland at that time, you know, it was muddy. The fields were muddy. You know, it rained a lot. And I'd just come back from, you know, a summer in America. So I remember the coach telling me, Charlie, shut up and stop talking to all the players like that because you're making them all jealous. And I think I kind of pissed them off. So Rochester called up and offered to buy my contract. And I was single and got a chance to go back and play in America where it was easy to peasy in my mind. And I thought, hey, why not just take the risk? So I went back over and played in Rochester in 1970. And they made me captain of the team. And we won the North American Soccer League title in 1970 with Rochester Lancers.
With your shirt out of your pants, with your jersey out of your shirt.
Sure, it'd be cool. They didn't know anything about Jim Baxter. I was the only one that knew about Jim Baxter, so I just wanted to play and look like him a little bit.
That's great. Then you go to New York Cosmos.
Yeah, that was a great experience. You know, I was I had a couple of good seasons with Rochester. We played against New York quite a few times. Well, Pelé came to New York in '75, so that was a big deal that he was getting all the publicity and so on and so forth. And then all of a sudden, the coach called me. This is 1976. The general manager called me up and said, New York Cosmos has made an offer for you to come and play in New York. That took me about 2 seconds to say, I'm in. Let's do the deal. And since we're talking about it, it's quite an experience because New York was owned by Warner Brothers, Warner's Communication. That's Warner Brothers movie people. So I had to go sign my contract down in New York in the Warner Brother building. As I get in the elevator to go up to the Warner Communications office, Robert Redford was standing in the elevator, and he said to me, "You one of these soccer players?" And I, obviously my accent was a little stronger at that time, and I said, "Yes, I am." And he started telling me how his son was playing soccer, and he thought it was a great sport. And he said, well, good luck to you. And I said, well, thanks very much. And that was my first experience in New York City in an elevator with Robert Redford. And then we go for lunch, and Rod Stewart's sitting in the restaurant at Warner Brothers. So I think I've hit the lotto. I've hit the lotto. So signed my contract and then moved to New York. And obviously Pelé was there. Then they signed Giorgio Canaglia. And he was a big star at that time as well. So we were the traveling party. Pelé and Canaglia were the one that got all the publicity. But it was just great to be in that environment and playing with so many good players.
Tell me about what it was like playing with Pelé, the king, the number one best soccer player in the world ever.
But, you know, Pelé at that time was he ended his career in 1977. And I'm telling you, he trained as hard as everybody. He worked hard. He didn't look for any. He wasn't a superstar amongst with the players. He traveled and coached with us in the plane. Here's a good story for you, Brandon. We finished the game and we're all sitting on the bus, and we're waiting for Pelé because he was getting interviewed by everybody and anybody he would talk to. And he probably held the bus up for about 10 or 15 minutes. And he came on the bus and he looked at everybody and said, "I apologize. I apologize for keeping everybody late, but I'm here to promote soccer in the United States. And I hope you all understand. So I am sorry." He used to say, sorry, boys. So, and his English was pretty good. We used to kid him on. When he was talking to women, his English was real good. And when he was talking to the reporters, his English wasn't so good. So, You can turn it on and turn it off.
That's great. I didn't know that about Pele. What's the biggest thing that you noticed about him that was like, that made him stand apart? Was it his work ethic? Was it just naturally talented? Was it his mindset?
He was just a, he could control the ball. I mean, I remember one time that a goalkeeper punted the ball out, and I was right behind him. He punted the ball out, and the ball was coming. I thought he was going to head it, and he just put out his foot and it dropped dead right on his foot. I mean, it was so many different things. Pele could have played defender. He could have played goalkeeper. He could have played any position because that's how good he was. You know, he could defend. I mean, in his day, if you go back and look at, he would chase people back again and tackle them and stuff like that. So he had a little knack for everything. It was really he was just great to be around. And like I said, his personality was one of the players. You know, he wasn't looking, acting like a big shot or nothing like that. He was a real deal. I don't know if you want to do some research, but you can go on YouTube and Pele did a bicycle kick, Cosmos against Fort Lauderdale at Yankee Stadium. And it shows me crossing the ball. And I assisted in Pele's only bicycle kick at what it was in North America. And after the game in the dressing room, he came over and gave me his shirt and says, I've always wanted to do that in America, Charlie. Always wanted to do that bicycle kick. Thanks for sending the ball over. And I used to kid people on since we're talking about, I looked up and I saw Pele and I thought I'd just chip it to Pele to do the bicycle kick. But that's not the real story. I just crossed the ball and Pele got on the end of it. But it sounds brag a little bit. I looked up and saw Pele, but I'm not that good. I just crossed the ball and he. So if any of your listeners are looking up on YouTube, Pele's bicycle kick, I was wearing number 19.
That's great. That's great. I'm sure you remember that cross like it was yesterday.
Oh, yeah. Well, my son's seen it 1,000 times and my grandkids have seen it 1,000 times. So I brag about it because it's one of these things I don't like to – I'm not really a big bragger because you just get this position where – but when you cross the ball to Pele and he does a bicycle kick at Yankee Stadium against Fort Lauderdale, it's a little – gives me a little bit of bragging rights.
Yeah, I can't think of anyone that I've ever spoke with that's done that before. So it's pretty special.
Well, that was it. Well, yeah. It's one of these things that, and fortunately, you know, now that was in 1976. We got it on tape, so there's no good talking about it and you can't back it up. So it's on tape somewhere.
All right. So then you went to Hawaii. What was it like playing out there?
That was another great experience. Like I said, Cosmos were bringing in Franz Beckenbauer. They're bringing in Carlos Alberto. They were starting to bring in the 77, bring in some really special players. So that put me on the bench. Well, I'd never been on the bench when I came to America. So I wasn't really comfortable, even though the glamour and the traveling, if you're not playing, it's just not the same. So there was a coach called Hubert Vogelsinger, who was the coach of Boston at that time. He got the job over in Hawaii, which was owned by Frito-Lay. Frito-Lay owned the team over. They bought the team and took it to Hawaii. So Vogelsinger always, he was a German coach. And when all the time I played against Boston, I seemed to play pretty good. So he offered me and a guy called Brian Tinian, who was another New York Cosmo player, to come and play for him in Hawaii. And that was in a Aloha Stadium over in Hawaii. And that was just you talk about going from Rochester to New York, you think you've hit the big time. Well, getting to Hawaii and playing professional soccer there, it was a kind of a huge, and we get good crowds over there. The teams had to travel over there, and they didn't like the traveling to come and play one game in Hawaii. And when we played there, we had to come to the mainland. We had to play two or three games in the mainland because you couldn't fly back and forth. So it was a long haul, but it was a great experience. And I was the captain of the team at that time. And it was we had a lot of English players, a couple of Brazilian players, a couple of German players. We had a good group of players. We won quite a few games.
Was the field like right next to the water?
No, the field was at Aloha Stadium. No, but it was the only stadium that had a what they also played baseball there, Brandon. So what actually they could do, that they took the seating and the seating would move around. The seating could move around for a baseball game. Then it was on big rollers. And then it would come back again and be square for a soccer game. So the people were looking at it just like a normal, like on a normal field. It was kind of neat to play in that stadium. And it was a great experience. A lot of traveling was involved in it. But then unfortunately, Hubert took ill. And once again, it's an interesting story. Hubert took ill and Wardley of Potato Chips called me up to his hotel room on an away trip and said, Hubert Stick would like you to take over the team. Well, I was 28 at that time. And I said, I'm not ready to take over a team. I just want to keep playing. I'm enjoying it. I said, but this is an interesting story. I said, but if you get the players to back me up with 10 games left in the season, and I said, if you let the players back me up and they all go for it, I'll do it. And his words to me was something I learned. We don't ask them. We tell them. Do you or don't you want the job? And I thought to myself, well, if I don't take it, somebody else is going to take it, and they don't know if they're going to like me. So I may as well just. So we played, and we made the playoffs, and we were playing against George Best, and George Best was with the Los Angeles Aztecs, and it was here's me coaching the team, playing against George Best, playing against Rodney Marsh in Tampa. It was, once again, I was way out of my element, but the players rallied around me and they ended up winning 6 of the last 10 games. So it was a great experience.
So how'd you end up in Tulsa?
Well, then the franchise wasn't making it in Hawaii because of the travel and it was too expensive. So they told us that the franchise was up for sale, and there's two people who'd come in, Cleveland. The town of Cleveland come in to buy the franchise, or the town of Tulsa come in to buy the franchise. And I remember looking at the map, and I saw where Cleveland was, and it was too far north for me, because I was actually, all my freckles were joining together. I was actually getting a tan. It took me about 12 months to get a tan in Hawaii, but I was getting a tan. And I looked in Dallas, I was familiar where Dallas was. We play Dallas Tornado all the time. And Tulsa was right next to Dallas. So I thought, oh, I might, hey, that'll do me. So fortunately, the franchise was bought and was brought to Tulsa. And if you do your homework, the coach was a guy from Manchester United called Bill Foulkes, F-O-U-L-K-S. Well, Bill Foulkes to me was a hero, because way back in the day, there was a big plane crash. Manchester United was in the plane crash. Bill Foulkes was one of the players in the plane crash.
Really?
And survived. So he was a big name in Manchester United. So he offered me to come to Tulsa and be his assistant coach and player. And once again, I landed on my feet, Brandon. I don't know how it happens all the time, but I landed on my feet. I landed in Tulsa. And I've never regretted it ever since. The Tulsa people welcomed me. They were great people to be around. Their soccer knowledge was limited, but they appreciated if you worked hard and you gave them a base honest effort. It was great. So I played in Tulsa in 1978 for Bill Foulkes.
Now, that was the Bisbee Babes, right? That plane accident?
You're right. You did your, that was the Bisbee Babes. He was on that team.
So I went to Manchester Stadium a couple years ago. And did the tour, and so I got to see like the clock that stopped at the time the plane crashed. And
okay, well then you're familiar that your knowledge is really good. Yeah, that was a big deal. And supposedly Bill Foulkes was the one that pulled Matt Busby out of the plane. Well, I don't know if that's true or not, but and he wouldn't talk about it. By the way, you know, I touched on it a couple of times, and he just said, "I don't want to talk about it, Charlie." So it was just like a guy called Dennis Filer, who ended up coaching in America as well. He was on that plane. So it was kind of a nice bit of history. So, but he was a good guy and all the credentials. So I was happy to be his assistant and play for him.
Okay, we're gonna circle back around to Tulsa once we finish talking about Toronto, and then we'll get into your coaching career. So you left Tulsa for Toronto.
Yeah, what happened is Bill Foulkes got fired, right? And I didn't think that at the time. I thought it was me personally. I thought it was wrong, and I was unhappy with that. Well, the captain of the New York Cosmos was a guy called Keith Eddy. He was a captain of New York Cosmos. So he gets a head coaching job in Toronto for the Toronto Blizzard, which was owned by the television station. So he called me up and said, hey, will you think I want to come to Toronto and be my assistant player coach? And I had a high respect for Keith because he was a really good player. He was English international, and we were good friends. And I thought, why not take the opportunity? Because the coach had came to Tulsa at that time. I didn't know him. He didn't. And it'd just be an uphill battle. So I jumped at the chance to go up there and play for him in Toronto. And we had a great season. And we made the playoffs. And first round of the playoffs was against New York Cosmos. And they knocked us out. So, and that was a great year. Good experience for me. Toronto was a great city. Good bunch of players. Once again, with mostly British players, a couple of Brazilian players, and a couple of Italian players. So it was a good mix of players that up there. And we get great crowds. We play the stadium up there. It was really but you know, the opening day, they had a snow blizzard on the opening day. And we had to play in the snow in the opening season. And I was reminded by that by looking at one of the old games. So great experience. Keith was good to play for. And then at the end of the season, we're sitting in the house, and Noel Lemon, the general manager of Tulsa, said, we've let Alan Hinton go. We're looking for a head coach. How would you like to come back to Tulsa? And that took 2 seconds as well. Tulsa, the people were great, very friendly. And I guess I could give you a good comparison here. Is that in New York, you had to fight in the subway. You had to fight to get a seat. You know, everybody was really pushy. Well, in Tulsa, in New York, somebody say, I need to invite you for dinner, and never invited you. Well, in Tulsa, when somebody said, I'm going to invite you for dinner, the next thing you knew, they called up and they invited you. That was the difference between Tulsa and living up in New York. So Tulsa's a great town. People are friendly, great environment, great schools for the children. So it was a no-brainer for me to come here as a head coach.
Now, you're considered one of the founding fathers of soccer in Tulsa. I was just talking to head coach Derek Larkin, and he said to tell you hi, by the way. And he said you and Victor are like huge role models when he was growing up, and you guys are like one of the reasons why soccer is what it is in Tulsa today.
Yeah, well, we're really fortunate with a lot of good players, Billy Caskey, Victor Mullen, that really went out in the community. And we did a lot of clinics. That was one of the things that we did a lot of when I became the head coach at Tulsa. We got the players involved in the community. And fortunately, with the British players and the players that we brought in all spoke English, so they could go out and work with the kids and do a lot of clinics. So we actually, Brandon, we did so many clinics. It was the kids who brought the parents to the game who had never seen the game before, didn't know what soccer was all about at Skelly Stadium. And we'd give away tickets like anything, and then they would take the ticket home to their parents and say, take me to that game, and whether parents liked it or not. And then all of a sudden, they became fans, and then we were getting 25,000, 30,000 people at Skelly Stadium. It was a great environment.
That's great. Were these free clinics you give to the kids?
Yeah, and free tickets. You know, anybody called us up and said, we'd like to do a clinic, we had players would show up. And when I signed the players, I would tell them, part of the deal is you have to come out and promote the sport. Well, why wouldn't you want to go out there and kick a ball with a bunch of kids and have fun? I mean, that's the job. It's not too bad a job to have, you know?
Yeah, of course. So what was it like? What was the biggest difference between you being a player versus a manager or coach?
It's a lot more fun being a player. because you're just responsible for yourself. You know, I know we're all team players. You hear everybody play for the team and all that. You go out there to play the best you can. If you don't play good, then you're responsible. If you play good, you get the credit. So it's all about you as a player. You just want to play, and then hopefully the other players think the same way. And if everybody's thinking the same way, then we're going to play well, play together. As a coach, you're responsible for 18 players. And if there's only 11 players on the team, there's 7 people pissed off at you somewhere along the line. And they all like to think. So as a coach, I can't talk about other sports, but it's a really tough job. You know, and it's easy to be criticized. Well, why doesn't he do this or why doesn't he do that? And if you were to turn around and say to your assistant, well, I remember a couple of things. My assistant was Alan Woodward, which was a great guy. Alan Woodward played for Sheffield United in England, the big superstar in England, great player, great guy. Well, he's my assistant coach. And him and I used to laugh. He said, Charlie, why don't you play that guy? I said, well, why don't you pick the team? And he go, wait a minute. No, I don't know. Well, I don't know. All of a sudden, when you tell an assistant coach or you to go to a player and say, okay, big shot, you go ahead and pick the team today. Well, it becomes a whole different story. So a lot of responsibility for any head coach, any sport. It's a tough job to please. You can't please everybody. It's impossible. So you just have to hopefully win games, and that pleases the owner.
Yeah, it's a lot more weight on your shoulders putting the whole 11 players versus just, play that one guy.
Yeah. And you live on the edge a little bit as well. Head coaches are only as good as the results. That's the bottom line. You're only good. If you're not going to win, you're going to get fired. And that's just the way of life, you know. And you know that going into it. And it's up to you to pick the best players that will keep you winning games. But not everybody can win a game, because if everybody was winning, then who would be losing? You know what I mean? There's going to be a winner and loser in every game. So you just hope you can win a lot more games than you lose. And the first year as a head coach, we were something like 13 and 10 or something like that, and we made the playoffs. So, and we were, and that year too, we played the New York Cosmos at Skelly Stadium and beat them 2-1 at Skelly Stadium. With Beckenbauer was playing, Kanagula was playing, Bokachevich was playing, all the Carlos Alberto was playing. But so that was one of the big highlights of my life, to beat New York in Tulsa. And Billy Caskey scored the winning goal, made it 2-1. Victor said he'd assisted on that, but I don't know if I believe him. But I've went back and checked. Victor tells everybody he assisted on that goal, so I may as well give him the credit.
Sounds good. So how'd you leave the Roughnecks and get into college to MSU?
I use one of the things that people do in Scotland and England a lot, and probably in Brazil and all over the world. If you're a popular player, everybody opens up a bar and let the crowd come and meet you in the bar. Well, in Oklahoma, you can't have a bar without a restaurant at that time. So I opened up a restaurant. I had a couple of guys who wanted to sponsor me, and I used my name, and we opened up the restaurant, Charlie Mitchell's Restaurant and Pub. It was successful for 10 years, and we had a great run at it. But just like everything else in Oklahoma, the franchises come in. When I was in the restaurant business, there was no franchises. So the franchises came in, so the restaurant wasn't doing so good after a while. And I got an opportunity to go coach in college, back to my passion. And I got an opportunity to go with Gil Cloud, was a athletic director at Northeastern State University. And he said, why don't you come and coach? And I jumped on it right away. And probably one of the most fun things I ever did.
I remember when I played for you, the biggest thing that I remember that I got better as a player was more just awareness and knowing where everyone was on the field and the quick 1-2 passes.
Yeah, I was big on that. I didn't want players to hang on the ball for a long time. The ball's supposed to be moving all the time. So if you could do it with two touch, do it with two touch. If you had to take that third touch, go ahead and take that third touch. But if you keep that ball moving, the ball moves a lot faster than players. So if you can keep the ball moving, the other team's going to have to adjust themselves all the time to move around. So, and I learned that from other coaches. You know, everything I did as a coach, I learned from Vogelsanger, from Keith Deary, from Bill Folk, and all the people. And that was stuff that I just took and copycatted. Because as a player, what you can remember is the things that when I was a player that coaches made us do that I enjoyed. That's what I wanted to do as a coach. I did all the drills that I enjoyed as a player. And I was a big proponent of all the practice should be done with the ball. You can sprint with a ball. You can do, if you remember, Brendan, we did a lot of stuff with the ball. We didn't do a lot of running around the track and stuff like that. We can get players fit by just chasing that ball and doing doggies and stuff like that.
Yes. What would you do to help your players increase their confidence?
Well, I tell you what, there's so many different players. There's players who've got the confidence in the first place, and they can be a little overconfident. And there's the players with no confidence, but they're good. So you got to instill confidence in the players that have got no confidence. You got to tell them that you're doing a good job. You know, it's a fallacy when people say, yeah, you got to be tough and be on everybody's ass all the time. That's not true. You've got to evaluate your player. There's players who have no confidence and need to be built up. And there's players you just got to get in their face and say, you're full of crap right now. You better just get your game together. But you got to find out what player can take it. Because if you take a player with no confidence and you get in his face, he doesn't want the ball. And in soccer, I wanted to put, apart from the goalkeeper, when that ball got on the field, I wanted everybody who wanted the ball. I want players who want the ball all the time. There's only one ball, so you can't give it to everybody. But I wanted players demanding the ball. That shows their confidence. If a player goes and hides and doesn't want the ball, then you have to build his confidence or he's not going to play. And you have to look at each individual as an individual and don't just treat them all the same way.
So it's not one size fits all. It's very individualized.
Yes, correct. You know, as a coach, you're a little bit of a you gotta be play mind games as well. You have to make sure you know how you're talking and how to motivate them, and how do you motivate the team? How do you get the team motivated to play? How do you get them pumped up? And I used to say to the players, I don't know if you recall this, if I've got to get you motivated, I've picked the wrong players. I want the players to come in that dressing room and basically get me motivated by being excited in the dressing room, looking forward to the game. I used to have a couple little tricks that when during the warm-up, I would never allow our players to look at the other team warming up. I wanted us to be so in control and so organized, I wanted the other team looking at us and going, oh shit, look at them. They're all, look how organized they are. Why are we not like that? Just a little mind game. It doesn't win you any games. It doesn't give you a goal or nothing, but it just gets you pumped up. And the players used to like that. They used to say, don't you be looking at the other team. Let's look organized and make sure they're looking at us. So that was one of my little tricks. I like to do, you know.
What were some other tricks you had?
I was big in just making sure that keep the ball moving. And I was big in when we got a free kick, you know, don't stand there and admire it. If it was in our half of the field, defensive half of the field, take a quick one. If it's in the offensive half of the field, then you can line it up and take a shot at goal. But if the ball is dead, don't be standing there. Stop the ball and goal, because normally the other team's walking back with their back to the ball and stuff like that. So I was always big in keeping that ball moving. Don't take any more touches than you have to. And just be aggressive. And win every ball first. You could win the ball first, then you've made it against your opponent. Then you're dictating. So attack the ball first. You're not going to win every ball. You're not going to win every tackle. But be there and get a piece of the player. If you didn't get the ball, get a little piece of the player.
What about sprinkling in fun to your practices and trainings? Did you have any tricks for making sure things stayed fun besides what you mentioned, which was keeping the ball in practice?
We did a lot. We used to do a lot of one and two touch and put two players in the middle, and they had to get the ball. And if you keep the ball away from them, if they got more than 10 touches without they getting the ball, they had to do 10 push-ups. You know, when you're in the circle, then they would come out, you send somebody else. So every time that you keep the ball away from the guys for more than 10 times, everybody were laughing because we all wanted the guys in the middle to do the push-up. So it just, that just gives team camaraderie. Now, all of a sudden, if they intercepted the ball before it got to 10, then everybody on the outside had to do 10 push-ups. So it was like, and then when the guy, and you're like this, the guy who did give up the ball, everybody's all mad at him for giving up the ball, because now, you know, everybody's good. So what it does is it's a team effort. If one guy screws up, then everybody has to do the push-ups. Just different stuff like that. The other one I used to do, and I don't know if you could call this, at the end of a practice, we'd line everybody up on the 18-yard line. And if you could chip the ball and hit the crossbar, then you could go take a shower. But if you didn't chip the ball and hit the crossbar, you had to stay out. I know, and you see some guys chipping and going away for a shower. But the funny thing is, the other guys didn't run in the shower. They would stand back and just watch everybody else and laugh. And there's always one guy who's going to be left chipping until about 10 or 15 minutes to end up getting it on the crossbar. And I used to do stuff like, let me take one, and I would hit it on the crossbar and say, okay, you can go. So it was just good camaraderie. I had a lot of fun with the guys' team. We won a lot of games, and we were competitive. It was fun with the guys. I didn't have any problems with any of the players. And I had some good players, and you can recall.
Yeah, my era was like Stewie. We had Bratters, some of the Jamaicans.
Right.
What was his name? I'm trying to remember now.
Yeah, a couple of English guys. It was Stewie and it was the other, his buddy. I'm trying to think who it was. And then, was Austin Greenhall there?
Juby?
Yeah. Austin was there.
John Michaels?
John Michaels and Austin. Remember, Austin played up front. John Michael. Austin came from Florida. And John Michael was a great little player. He played out wide. You know, we had a good bunch of players. You know, it was a good experience. And we had fun. I hope you recall we had fun as well.
We did.
I could be tough, but I didn't have to be because, you know, you were dealing with young men who were becoming adolescents. And the only thing I used to worry about was we went on the away trip because I let some of the older players have a beer and the younger players couldn't. That's where man management came in. And you had to be sensible and make sure, because it was college and you're responsible for people's sons, and that was a responsibility. At a professional level, I didn't feel that responsibility. If somebody wanted to go have a beer, that was their choice, and they had to live with it. But as a college coach, you had to make sure that you followed the rules, make sure they followed the rules, because they were adolescent. You know, they weren't men yet.
So you had a little bit of extra responsibility.
Oh yes, I mean it was. You had to make sure that they followed the rules. And, you know, we're all 17, 18, and 19, so they didn't, you know, a couple of times. I remember one night that, this is before you came, but I had a couple of players from Holland, Xander and Danny, and they were really good players. But one night somebody told me they were out at a bar when I had put a curfew on. So I thought, I went to the bar to find them, and they weren't there. And it was some of the tennis players were there, and goes, oh, coach, they never came in here. And all of a sudden, next day, I went to practice. He goes, hey, I heard you were looking for us last night. And I goes, yes, I was. And you better be happy. I think, well, the tennis players told us you were coming, so we all went home. So I said, well, that's a good. Because if you remember, the tennis players were mostly Spanish guys, and they were the soccer players and the tennis players got along great. So they were covering each other's ass.
Yeah, you got to be more. You had to be more stealthy.
Yeah. Well, as a coach, what you don't know doesn't hurt you. So if you're going to do something, you better make sure the coach doesn't find out about it.
What were some of your tricks or tactics you had to build leaders within your team?
Well, actually, you know that comes from them as well. Like I always looked at people that. Easily, you could always tell in the dressing room who looked up to who and who kind of was the talker, or who was the guy who was helping making decisions for people, or who was the leader. And that's the guy that obviously you want to captain the team. But the same thing is you have to bring him in as an individual and say, hey, you're an asset to me. I need you to be that asset. So take on the responsibility I give you. And when you win him over, he wins everybody else over. Because in the college level, the other players listen to the captain before they actually listen to the coach, because he was an extension of the head coach. So you had to make sure you picked a captain that was an extension of you and doesn't make you look bad or go do things that you wouldn't appreciate. So I always look for the guy who they actually pick themselves. Does that make sense to you, Brandon? I go up there and say, I like Brandon, I'm going to make him captain. I looked around to see who they followed, who was a role model to them. And it was normally a senior. You know, it was normally somebody that had played a couple of years for the team and knew what was going on. So when the freshmen came in or the sophomores came in, they knew that, don't worry about, you better not piss him off, the captain, because he'll jump all over your A. And it made my job easier. So I gave them responsibility to take care of the dress, what I call take care of the dressing room.
What about goal setting? Would you write out goals for yourself, both as a player and then as a manager? Would you write them down, or would you just have them in your head? Tell me about that.
I would set up goals at the beginning of the year. I would realistically look at the schedule, and I would look at every team we're going to play against, home or away, and I'd write a result down there, what I thought would be a realistic result, and then see if we could follow that. And I was out of 20 games, if we didn't win 15, I'd be disappointed. That would be my goal. 75% of the season, if you pick the right players, there's going to be games that you should win and you lose. And there's going to be games that you should maybe lose, you should win. And we had a couple of good, you know, there were some good teams in that league at that time. So we can win every game, but the same thing is that we're going to be in every game. And I always wanted to win every game at home. I don't know what it is about people being at home. Well, number one, you don't have to stay in a hotel room. You don't have to eat strange food. So you should feel more comfortable playing on your home field. So I wanted to win every home game. And the other thing is, I was big in getting the players in good shape. I wanted them to feel that they could run longer and run more than the other team. And we not running around a track that was just worked on. If you can recall, we used to do a thing called doggies. You run 10, come back 10, run 20, come back 20. And you don't kill the player, but it's great for stamina, because nobody runs the whole 90 minutes in a soccer game. People say you run for 90 minutes. You don't run for 90 minutes. You run periodically, but there's times you're standing. So that's the way you should try and practice like that. Make a hard run, then take a break, then hard run and take a break. But most of the stuff I like doing with the ball, shooting drills, defensive drills with the ball. It's all about having control of the ball, having the ball do the work for you. One of my theories was, let the ball do the work, because the ball moves faster than the player.
Yes, it does. Yes, it does. Did you have any superstitions or rituals?
Not really. No, I don't believe in that. I don't believe in that. I try not to believe in it. You know, if we had a bad game, or as a player, if I had a bad game, I'd like to think my next game was going to be a good one. But that, I'm not really into that. It's up to you. I'm big in, you should know, believe in yourself, be aggressive, and go for it. Don't think, don't overthink it. Don't second guess yourself. Just go out there and make it happen. And every game I played in, or every game we coached, there was going to be mistakes made. And that was one of the things I used to say to the players. If you make a mistake, who cares? Just don't make two. Go ahead and just come back and recover. Because most people, when you make a mistake, you think everybody sees it. They really don't. They're just go back and cover up for the mistake you made and try not to make two in a row. Because we're all going to make mistakes. I'll make a mistake today, wherever my lifestyle today, I'm going to make a mistake somewhere along the line. But if nobody knows about it, I'm not going to tell them. So we're just going to just keep moving on.
I like it. Yeah, a lot of players, they'll make a mistake in the middle of the game and it'll ruin the entire rest of their game.
Right, and that's a good point. And you know, I know you watch games like I do. I watch the English Premier League as much as I can. I really enjoy watching that. I like watching the Bundesliga. But I'll tell you what, a lot of players will make a bad pass and they don't give a crap. And it's happening more and more. If you watch the modern day soccer players, they'll take a shot from 20 yards that goes over the bar, and they walk back smiling. Well, that was never done in my day. If you hit a ball and you hit it over the bar, you were like, oh, that moan and groan. Not anymore. These players take, they, it's a whole different game. They take a chance and it doesn't work, no big deal, you know what I mean? Because they know that the next thing they might hit it from 20 yards and go up in the top corner. So, but that's a modern player who's got confidence in himself. And if they make a mistake, they don't care. The coach is not jumping all over the place for making a mistake. I mean, it's part of life on the field, and it's part of the life off the field.
What's one thing that you know now that you wish you could have told your 18-year-old self, soccer player, to be better?
That's a great question. I think I would have probably gotten in their head a little more than I did. I would have probably brought more people into the dressing, into the office, to give advice how to handle themselves on the field, on how they should play on the field. I wish I'd done more one-on-one with some players, where I didn't do enough of that. I kind of depended on the captain of the team, kind of passing it on to him. And I'll give people advice in the dressing room in front of everybody. I wish I'd done a little bit more one-on-one. I was scared to show favoritism because, you know what, oh, the coach likes him better than me. I didn't need that, but I should have done some more, brought people in, had a discussion, and did a little more blackboard on the blackboard behind my office to show how they should have made some better runs or how they should make better decisions. I didn't spend enough time in that.
And that's towards your coaching side. What about towards your as a player? What would you tell your player self?
Say that again, Brandon.
Sorry. So what you just said was that was kind of like you as a manager, as a coach, what you would have done differently. What about as a player during your playing career? What's one thing you could tell your old self as a player?
Yeah, well, this is easy. I wish I'd known as a player what I knew as a coach. I'd have passed the ball quicker. I'd have made better decisions on the field. I would have done. I'd have held the ball in different areas where before I was getting rid of the ball quickly because I didn't want to make a mistake. I was so busy trying not to make a mistake as a player that I should have had more confidence in myself. But I played with some good players, and I was trying not to make a mistake. If I could do it all over again, I'd have been a lot more confident on the ball and did things I knew I could do, but I never ever tried it because I was around some really quality players, and I just didn't want to look bad. So I took the easy way out, made an easy pass when I should have done some other stuff.
Great answer. And last but not least, what advice would you give college players now who are with this coronavirus thing going on, who are stuck at home, are trying to stick to some sort of workout schedule, but, I mean, not being on the field with other players, I'm sure it gets boring and monotonous. What advice would you tell them to kind of, like, keep their spirits up?
If they've got the opportunity to watch some old games on the television, you can learn a lot from watching other players play, and especially if you watch, like, the Bundesliga or the Spanish league or the English Premier League, that's a good. But as individuals and keep yourself in shape, there's a lot of things you can do. You can do bench press, and you can do exercise around the living room. You can keep yourself. You know, you've got to keep these muscles stretched all the time, so that when it does come time to play, you're not going to pull a muscle. So they should be stretching continuously, and they all know how to do that nowadays. They all know how it's done by the trainer, showed them how to do it. So they should be doing stretching, you know, calves, thighs, hamstrings, all the lower part of the body. So that when it does come time to run again and do some different stuff with the ball, the muscle's not going to be tight. So I would be very surprised if not every professional or good college player is not up there stretching. And you can stretch anywhere. You can stretch in a hallway. You can stretch anywhere. But especially on the lower part of the body, nowadays, it's getting really, 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 really in the weight room. A lot of players are doing upper body weights. I was never into that because we were told that you don't want to get too muscular in the upper part of your body. It slows you down. I don't know if I agree with that or not anymore, but the modern-day player and the good college players and anybody, they know what it's like in the training room. If you can make up your own little training exercise in your bedroom or in the hallway or in the living room, go ahead and do it. But most importantly, keep stretching, keep your muscles stretched so that when it does time to go up there and run and open up a little bit, your muscles not going to get pulled or ting on you and all of a sudden it puts you out for a couple of weeks.
Great advice. Charlie, thank you so much for being on the podcast today. It's been great reconnecting with you. I've loved hearing your stories. And I think we can agree that we all owe your success to Robert Redford saying good luck on the elevator that day.
We'll go from there, but it's just great how soccer can take you in every directions and make you put you in positions that you would never ever imagine. So I've been very, very fortunate in my soccer career, my coaching career as far as a professional in college. It's been a great experience, and I'm just happy that you gave me the opportunity to tell some people some of the background, the stories that people probably didn't know about.
That's great. Thank you. All right.
Good luck to you. Great seeing you, and take care of yourself and take good health.
All right. You too.
Cheers.
Thank you.